Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Everybody have a blessed week.
Amen.
I told them not to pass that cake out. I was taking it home, so everybody ate some of that cake. You owe me a dollar. That's a dollar for the cake, because you just took away some of my pleasure. So. Bye, yes. Dear Heavenly Father, in the name of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, we just come to you right now, Father God, just thanking you for this day. Just thank you for this opportunity to minister to your people one more time, Father God. I just ask you, Father God, in the name of Jesus, to open up their eyes that they may see, their ears that they may hear, and their heart that may receive all that you have for them, Father God. And just let your spirit flow, Father. We're just going to just wait on you and do whatever the Holy Spirit have us to do, Father God. And we give you all the praise and glory as we walk out of here, not the same as we came in, Father God. For that is what you have asked us to do, is to seek understanding, Father God. For we get in your knowledge, but we get understanding from you opening up our eyes. So we just thank you right now, Father God, for all that you've done. We thank you for our pastor. We thank you for each and every one that is here right now. We give you the praise and glory in Jesus Christ's name. And everybody say amen.
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 I know we got that food in us and it was good.
Excellent.
It was excellent.
Excellent.
Well, you all know how excellent it is. I'm going to go home and go to bed. No. Little bad news, but a little good news. I originally told you all this was going to be an 8-week thing. We're going to have to cut it back because of the holiday. We're not thinking we're going to have to cut this back 6 weeks. And then we're going to pick it up again after the holiday. So it's just not like you're not going to be investing anything. But we want to put an ending to it before the holiday. So actually, this, we got two more classes after this. So today I'm going to jump into, and I'm literally going to jump into covenant. So you all going to have to flow with it and understand it. And we're going to just touch the highlights on covenant. So we're going to take all next week to deal with marriage. Does everyone have one of these? This one here. Everybody has this?
Yeah.
I'm sorry. I
want you to go through this and be prepared next week. Next week when we talk about marriage, you all are going to teach the class. Uh-oh. So just go through this. And be prepared for this next week. I'm just going to teach the class, but I want a lot of discussion on this. Do you, everyone, have this? This is kind of outlined. Like I said, I just talked about that. It's not going to be 8 weeks. It's only going to be 6 weeks. Everyone should have the outline. Definitions. Definitely have these definitions. We're going to redo them and make them look a little prettier, but looks is not my main concern right now. And these definitions are kind of the foundation of everything. You have to get these definitions down because they're going to set, like I said, set the foundation of everything we're talking about. So this week, what are we talking about?
Covenant.
Interesting. So you got the definition there. Somebody give me a definition of covenant. What is covenant?
An inseparable,
unbreakable bond between God and man.
Mm-hmm.
With that in mind, can man have a covenant with another man? Or
no.
Huh?
Can they have an agreement?
They have an agreement, even though in the Bible there is situations that they stated, like David and Jonathan. Stated that they have a covenant relation. You have in the Middle Eastern culture that they people or families will create a covenant between each other. But in actuality, and to distinguish the difference between men having covenants with each other and God with only you can have a covenant, distinguish the difference, you hear people make this statement, blood covenant. God has a blood covenant.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I didn't find that in the Bible.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't see it nowhere say blood covenant.
No.
It just said covenant.
Covenant.
So, it is, which is kind of a kind of honoring God, you know, when the best form of honoring somebody is to emulate them. So, it is man's attempt to try to emulate some of the things that God was doing with man. But actuality, Only somebody that can create a covenant, have a covenant, is between with God, God himself, because he's going to create a means. We understand also, before I get into a few covenants, while we're talking about covenant, get an understanding of what covenant is. Covenant is broken down into basically three different areas. Anybody remember those three different areas in which covenant is broken down in? Those of you that have been in previous classes. Covenant is broken down into three different areas so we can understand what makes up a covenant. Anybody remember those three different areas that make up a covenant? Transcendence. What does transcendence mean?
God is in charge.
So covenant has this makeup of being transcendent, meaning God is in charge. And how can man have a covenant with man without God being in charge? So it's not really, man can't really have a covenant with each other. It's got to be from God. What's the other one?
Hierarchy.
Hierarchy, which means what?
Order.
So whose order are we talking about? God's order. So that's another indication that a covenant can only come from God. You can only have a covenant with God. And we're going to get into that because there's actually two different covenants. And what's the last one?
Ethics.
Ethics. It's what?
God sets the rule or boundaries.
God sets the rules or boundaries. So understanding what a covenant is made up and having these three different areas we're talking about, we're going to get into this and we're going to have to apply this to a marriage. We know that a marriage is made up of love. Now we learn that marriage is made up of covenant. It's got to have this thing called covenant. And covenant is kind of like the bubble that surrounds everything and keeps everything together. Covenant is kind of the thing that sets the rules and the regulation. Covenant is kind of the thing, it is the thing that makes covenant unbreakable. Because it is transcendent, meaning that it is God in charge, it's unbreakable, not unconditional, because we're going to find out we have a few covenants that are unconditional. We have what's called conditional covenants that God made, and then there's unconditional covenants that God made. But if you study these covenants out, and I'm going to have you all read a few. If you study these covenants out, you'll find out that the structure of it, the rules and regulations of it, the purpose of it, just carries on from one covenant to God's word never changes. God's word is everlasting. So if he said it, it doesn't mean that he's going to create another covenant to change his word. That one covenant just flows into another covenant. Nothing changes. The perception of it or how we look at it may change or how he presented to it. It's kind of like he said, well, you all are not doing very good on this side of the mountain. Let me take you to the other side of the mountain and take a look at it from there. It's still the mountain. Nothing's changed. His word ain't changed. The purpose of his word hasn't changed because he's going to show you how to get to the top of the mountain. What side of the top of the mountain that you deal from kind of reflects the covenant. And you'll see that old covenant versus the new covenant. And we'll see, we're going to get into that. We're going to have to kind of read that. So you have these three different areas of covenant. We're supposed to try to find a man. We're going to get into that about men creating covenant. But first, we're going to look at how God created covenant. First covenant that was created, Adamic covenant. Anybody want to read that list? I'm going to get some reading shit. We're going to have it. Somebody read that.
Adamic covenant found in Genesis 1:26-30 and second chapter of Genesis 16 through 17. This covenant is general in nature. It included the command not to eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, pronounced a curse for sin, and spoke of a future provision for man's redemption. Genesis 3:15.
Okay, we all know what happened in the original sin and stuff. But I'll get into it. But I want you to see that there was some conditions there, right? Mm-hmm. There was conditions. If you do this, then this will happen. Mm-hmm. So this will be a conditional covenant. Understand it. Just get an understanding what conditional covenant it is. So God, in the Adamic covenant, set the rules. He set the boundaries. He set the relationship. And all this was to do what? What is the meaning of relationship? Gotcha. Your definition, ship? What's the meaning of relationship?
The way, words, or connected.
State of being connected. The Adamic covenant was set up for what? It was set up to create a way that Adam and Eve could stay connected with God. It gave them the means and the rules and regulations by which Gavin and Adam and Eve could stay connected with God. So when they broke the covenant, what happened?
They were disconnected.
See how they're out of order. Come on now. Y'all getting there. Mm-hmm. Y'all going to be able to walk here a little bit, and you're going to hear things, and you're going to say, oh, that ain't in order. I don't care how much prosperity might be happening with it. I don't care how many miracles you might think you're seeing or they might emulate. It ain't in order. Mm-hmm. And if it ain't in order, it's not of God. Because we are entering a time right now where the devil is masterful at deception.
Yeah, he is.
Masterful at deception. Kind of like you're really going to have to do like Pastor Hagin. So Brother Hagin used to tell us, learn how to chew the straw and spit out the sticks.
Yeah. Spit out the sticks.
You gotta get rid of the sticks quick. Now you can't even ponder with them a little bit. Mm. So, first covenant, a conditional covenant, to keep Adam and Eve in the glory of God. So, because in that glory, they can communicate, they can connect with God. Once they lost that glory, then it was a whole other ball game. But God, being God, he knew that. He knew that. He had a plan in mind. He had it all set up. Anybody want to read this next covenant for us?
I'll read it.
What kind of covenant is it?
Noahic covenant.
Noahic covenant. Got to deal with Noah. Go ahead.
This generational covenant was made between God and Noah following the departure of Noah, his family, and the animals from the ark, found in Genesis 9:11. I establish my covenant with you that never again shall all flesh be cut off by the waters of the flood, and never again shall there be a flood to destroy the earth. This covenant included a sign of God's faithfulness to keep it, the rainbow.
So, did you hear a condition in there? What was the condition? It all fell on God.
Right.
So there really was no condition. So this is an unconditional covenant. So I want you to grasp, I'm going to have to spell it out for you. A conditional covenant involves what? Man has some rules and regulations he has to do. Unconditional covenant is basically the promise of God to man. What he promised, he don't care what you do, what happens with you, he's going to do it this way. He set this covenant up. He's going to be faithful to you. And I should have told you all, told you a definition of the true definition of covenant. This word covenant, so you get an understanding of how covenant came about. This word covenant in the Hebrew, I can't pronounce the name, but it means to cut. It means to cut. So how does that relate? How are we going to relate it to a marriage? That's where people get the term blood covenant. Because to cut, you got to bring about blood to sanctify or to establish this covenant. So keep that in mind. So first covenant, with Adamic covenant, was conditional. Second covenant was unconditional. Noah's covenant. We all know the story between Noah and Noah built the ark. You know, saved mankind. Well, God saved mankind because Noah was obedient to build the ark. You know, just briefly stated, and animals came there two by two. All right, somebody else want to get number three for me? Abrahamic covenant.
Abrahamic covenant. This unconditional covenant, first made to Abraham in Genesis 12, 1 through 3, promised God's blessings upon Abraham to make his name great and to make his progeny into a great nation. The covenant also promised blessings to those who blessed Abraham and cursings to those who cursed him. Further, God vowed to bless the entire world through Abraham's seed. Circumcision was the sign that Abraham believed the covenant, Romans 4 and 11. The fulfillment of this covenant is seen in the history of Abraham's descendants and in the creation of the nation of Israel. The worldwide blessing came through Jesus Christ, who was of Abraham's family line.
All right. So what kind of covenant is this? This is an unconditional covenant, meaning that God made some promises. This covenant would never end. None of these covenants actually ever end. They just kind of roll into each other. The rainbow is still a sign of what? That God won't do that. We still got the rainbow. Adamic covenant, we get into a little deeper because the Adamic covenant has to deal with the marriage. We're still getting married. Not understanding why we're getting married, but we don't. You all do. Let me take that back. You all got a full understanding. You got the definitions. You're going to walk out of here boldly. Somebody going to say, I'm getting married. You know what I mean? Somebody here told me that that was Al. Someone coming to him and asked him about marriage, and he asked him, say, you know what marriage means? And he got the quote and tell him what marriage means, and he kind of blew him out the door. But the average person, try it. Ask an average person out there, do they know, give me a biblical definition of marriage. Oh, they'll tell you what the world says, but give me a biblical definition of marriage. Don't know, can't do it. So we got the Abrahamic covenant, where God made a lot of promises. And in that Abrahamic covenant came the seed. It didn't say seeds, did it? It says seed. In that Abraham covenant came the seed. You have to understand that. Reason you have to understand that, because that seed is where we get our salvation. In that seed that we get our inheritance. In that seed, we have to be in that seed. The Bible tells us that and gives us so many examples. It says, in Christ, who is the seed. In him. Reason why I'm emphasizing that, because a lot of us, I get the sense, still don't understand that we're not in the image of God. We're in the image, when you're born in the image of Adam. You must be born again, and then being born again, you're in Christ. And once you're in Christ, God doesn't see you, he sees who? Christ. He sees Christ. So there's a big difference between Adam and Eve and us. You have to understand that. A lot of people, because we're going around, we get these false impressions of being, I've heard people call other people that are even not even born again, knowing that this is God's creation, but because it's God's creation, everybody is not a child of God.
That's right. That's right.
But they will tell you, you are a child of God, even though you're not born again. And you're not. That's why we got, it's so important, that's why I like pastors emphasizing this, that we've got to get down and pray. Mm-hmm.
prayer. We've got to get strength. We've got to get boldness and start witnessing to people. You can't go out and let people walk around here and fall off into hell.
That's right.
We can't do it. We're going to be held accountable.
Too much at stake.
Too much at stake. They talk about Black Lives Matter, one life matters.
That's right. Yeah.
No matter what it is or who it is, one life matters. And that life that God has brought before you, you've got to understand that God brought that life before you to witness to it. Oh, to witness to him or her. I got to get away from saying it. It's him or her. They're not it. They're God's creation.
Yeah.
And God loves that. He loves them. And it's very dangerous. That's why we got to pray for our enemies. That's why we got to shower those who abuse us with kindness, because they're still God's creation. And he loved his creation so much that he gave his son, trying to get that creation back to him, reconciled back to him. He created the beings. And I'm going to say this right now for all you married people, and even you unmarried people who are close. Specifically, you married people, it is very, very dangerous to abuse one another, because you're abusing a child of God. So if you walk around and you popping your spouse upside the head emotionally, mentally, or physically, watch out. And all they got to do is sit still, and God's going to pop you right now. So work out your salvation with fear. Knowing that God ain't no toy.
That's right.
You know, there's a lot of fuzziness going on about God, but this is God when it comes to his creation, when it comes to his glory. He gets very, it's, he don't play. We're in this period of grace, and we, a lot of us are getting relaxed in this period of grace, but his wrath is coming. Oh, real okay. Soon. All right, let me get back. How do I get on that?
Go and preach. Go and preach a little bit.
Wow. He said, go and preach. Now, let me get off that soapbox a little bit.
It's the truth. It's the truth.
But let's go. Who you might want to read number four? Palestinian covenant.
Now, Palestinian covenant. This unconditional covenant found in Deuteronomy 30:1-10. Noted God's promise to scatter Israel if they disobeyed God, then to restore them at a later time to their land. This covenant has been fulfilled twice, with the Babylonian captivity rebuilding of Jerusalem under Cyrus the Great, and with the destruction of Jerusalem in AD 70. Followed by the reinstatement of the nation of Israel in 1948.
And I'm going to ask you a question. I'm just going to show you how this world has become very deceptive. Why is it called the Palestinian Covenant? Most of us don't even know. Israel was called Palestine. The Jews were called Palestinians. By who? By the Romans. When the Romans came in and destroyed Israel, they changed it to wipe them off the map to so nobody know who. They changed their name and changed the city to Israel, to Palestine. What do you think? Where's Palestine right now? Where's the land of Palestine? Y'all watch the news. They talk about getting the West Bank. Where's the West Bank? Where's all that? It's in Israel. Sometimes we do a little critical thinking and we can figure out that something ain't quite right. If Palestine is in Israel, you got these people who don't come from that area, call themselves Palestinians, and they're supposed to belong to the land, but yet they don't come from that area of the land, something's going on. Somebody's making up something somewhere. Because the original people in the land, the original people who are called Palestinians, are the Jews. So this Palestinian covenant is all about the land. Jewish land, God's land. That's what it actually is. It's God's land. And how God is going to scatter them, and he did, and how he's bringing them back, and he did. Someone want to read the next one for me?
Mosaic Covenant. This conditional covenant found in Deuteronomy 11 and elsewhere promised the Israelites a blessing for disobedience and a curse for disobedience. A blessing for obedience and a curse for disobedience. Sorry. Much of the Old Testament chronicles the fulfillment of this cycle of judgment for sin and later blessing when Jesus' people repented and returned to God.
All right, the Mosaic covenant is what kind of covenant?
Conditional
covenant. These covenants, if you have to pay attention to order, how they're laid out. It's trying to tell you something. God is trying to say something to us in this in the great, because the Old Testament are types and shadow of something. I'm going to tell you something, because I'm going to give you a little challenge. Next week, we're going to get into the marriage. But if someone, I'm not going to give it all to you, then I might be. I'm going to see if you can hear it when I do it. But if someone can put this all together and give me a scriptural, two or three scriptures to find what's happening here, I have a $10 gas card for you. They got a little challenge. $10 quick trip gas card. You can do it by next week and bring it up as part of the discussion next week. I have a $10 gas card for you. But Mosaic Covenant is a conditional covenant in which God pronounced cursing if they don't do it and blessing if they do do it. Mm-hmm. Are we kind of going through that right now? Mm-hmm. Are we in a covenant, a conditional or non-conditional covenant?
It's conditional.
Conditional? Mm-hmm. Let's read on and see. What's the next one?
Davidic covenant.
Somebody read that?
This unconditional covenant found in 2 Samuel chapter 7, verses 8-16, promised to bless David's family, line, and assure an everlasting kingdom. Jesus is from the family line of David. Luke chapter 1, verses 32-33. And as the son of David, Mark chapter 10, verse 47, is the fulfillment of this covenant.
Anybody know right offhand how Jesus was related to David? Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Who? You say Miss Hill?
Oh, I was just reading down here. I'm sorry.
Anybody know? Yeah. Can briefly tell me how was Jesus related to David? Mm-hmm. Actually, two ways, but one of them is covered in both. Who's his mother?
Mary.
Mary is bloodline of David. Huh?
Yeah.
Joseph
as well.
Joseph both. See, that's where we gotta get. Joseph actually bloodline for the kingly part of it, but Mary's bloodline brought about the priestly part and the kingly part. Mary is actually related both to indirectly through David and directly through the priesthood. Joseph is related directly to David. So God had it covered that if something happened to Joseph, Jesus still would inherit the priestly line and the kingly line. It was God's original intent that there would be no kings, no priests, Lord, one Lord, God himself, Jesus himself would be that Lord. And we would be in a kingly position and a priestly position. He wants us to do both. And those both actually weighed out and played out in a certain manner. We are to be kings and we are to be priests. We are to be kings and we are to be priests. I'm talking to y'all. What's the next one? Who wants to read that one?
This covenant, found in Jeremiah 31:31-34, promised that God will forgive sin and have a close, unbroken relationship with his people. The promise was first made to Israel and then extended to everyone who comes to Jesus Christ in faith. Matthew 26:28, Hebrews 9:15.
The Bible tells us that in the new covenant, he's going to write the laws on our heart. The Mosaic covenant didn't end. The Mosaic covenant now became written on our hearts. That's why we are in a position, God has created this position called grace. Because if you get out of the flesh and walk in the Spirit as who you are, the things that God has provided for you, you begin to see them. They're already there. You begin to do them naturally. That's why it's so much emphasis on walking in the Spirit. Not just our spirit, and not just in his spirit, brother, but in our spirit, in who we are. I like to tell my youth, I say this so much to them, quit acting like a chicken. You know, plucking around on the ground and be who you are, eagle flying high, because you are a spiritual being now. You're no longer a fleshly being. You've been born, reborn of the Spirit. Adam is of the flesh, but Christ is of the Spirit.
That's it. That's it. Yes, yes, yes.
Amen.
That's it.
Come on now. Put this order together for you. Adam is of the flesh, but Christ is of the Spirit.
Yes,
we are
yes,
in
yes.
Christ.
Thank you, Jesus.
That's why it was so important that we were born again. That's why it's so important as to what Jesus did on that cross. We still can't fathom everything he did for us on that cross. We only can comprehend just a small bit of it in salvation. We really don't understand it. Because we really don't understand who Adam was. What Adam had, what Adam did. We lost that. Adam and Eve, Adam spoke and things came about.
Mm-hmm.
Just like God spoke and things come about.
Mm-hmm.
Adam spoke life into the animals. It's not even recorded. All the things that Adam and Eve did. It tells you the position they had, and the position was what? Come on, y'all. Authority, dominion.
Mm-hmm.
They had authority, dominion over this earth.
Mm-hmm.
We really don't know how long a period it went between when they running around with all this authority to the time that they fail.
Mm-hmm.
But we know there is a period of time that they walk this order in a complete authority,
mm-hmm.
complete dominion. And this earth was not like what it is now.
Mm-hmm.
I mean the structure. I mean the way plants grow, things happening, the whole, because you know, the Bible tells us that even the earth and the things in the earth are groaning to get back to where it used to be. Paraphrasing. So Adam and Eve, who had dominion, had something set up that was so awesome that we have no idea. We have no idea. But this what we do know, that this whole earth is groaning to get back to what Adam and Eve was doing. And maintaining it back before the sin. We just got to read these things and just seek understanding, not seek just to accept some things. We walk by faith, not by sight. But we don't walk without understanding. We seek that understanding. The Bible tells us when we get knowledge, the next thing you should be doing is to seek understanding. Because if you just take that knowledge and try to ride on it, it's going to do what? Puff you up.
That's right.
The Bible tells us to test the spirits. What spirit do you think they're talking about? Words are spirit. Anybody, what they speak, words are spirit. What anybody say, what I say up here. Don't sit up here and take what I say to be.
That's right.
Law. Study it out for yourself. Study to show yourself to be approved. Study to show yourself. Not to prove nothing to God. Study to show yourself. To gain that understanding so you can stand in a boldness and know. I'm trying to tell you something that we've got to get to as individuals, that we've got to come to an understanding as individuals. Because when we come to that understanding and we get that foundation as individuals, it's like taking two halves of a magnet and put it together. The power that's going to generate when you come together as a marriage. Having dominion over your environment. Any questions?
No. What do you do for winning the...
Am I actually going to tell you?
I don't know.
Keep going. So understand that covenant is like the balloon that surrounds everything. Y'all okay? That holds everything. I am trying to ignore you because you're trying to get somebody. being me, if you prod me too much, I'll go ahead and spew it out because I like talking about it. But covenant is that balloon or environment that surrounds everything and holds it all together. Holds our relationship with God together. Give us that rules, that regulations. Love is what? If you can put it in that same vernacular, love would be what? Love would be what?
God and spirit.
Come on now.
Love is God and spirit.
Love would be who we are. That accept the fact of those rules and regulations that we operate in. Love will be who we are. Because we are love. Our spiritual being. We are love. God is love. So once you're born again, you have the what?
Love of God.
You have the love of God. And a sound mind. Power.
Yes.
See, we look over those things and say, what power? Power. Now, how many people that you know go around and love actually act with a state of power? God's getting ready to bring back something. You're going to see some people walking around that's going to... I believe it's happening now. Not so much in America, but you see a lot of it overseas in terms of people laying hands on the dead. And they're coming back to life. But I'm believing it's going to come back. God's power is going to come back here. God's power is here. I think the problem is we're letting it be dormant. That power is here. But it can't flow because of the things we do being in the world. Our lack of understanding as to who what we are. It's like I say about the chicken. Not a chicken, it's an eagle. Got the wings, got the power.
And it can soar.
Just in the wrong place, doing the wrong thing because they've been taught and established the wrong state of mind. They got the wings, what's bad about us, we walk around in that chicken coop in the world, and we look so out of place, and we're still trying to fit in with something we're not supposed to fit in with.
My God.
I see it every day. Just, I see people that's oozing with God's anointing, trying to please the world. What am I talking about? I'm talking about marriage. So I gave you this brief. I'm jumping on covenant. I wanted to get into this a little deeper because we kind of shortened this up. I gave you this brief understanding, part of which we learned before, of how covenant is broken up into what three areas? Transcendence, hierarchy, and ethics. You break either one of these, you don't have a covenant. If you break either one of these, the covenant may exist, but you're out of order. Out of order. The sin that we kind of play with and bounce on and use it to create nothing, the original sin is not a sin in terms of being just disobedient, but it's a sin of getting out of order. It's just as simple as that. But we will complicate sin. Oh, they did this. She had lust of the eye. She had this. She had that. All she really had was some things that all of us have to deal with, but if you're dealing with it, you go to your spouse or you go to God to deal with it, you don't get out of order. Mm-hmm. Bible tells us to be angry, mad, but don't sin.
Don't sin.
Even Jesus was tempted. We're going to be tempted. You think the temptation is something that just happens outside yourself? Temptation is something that happens outside yourself, but the temptation don't come until you conceive it in your head. Then you're tempted. Because if it just happens outside yourself and you don't conceive it in your head, what it does, it goes over your head. You have no perception of it whatsoever. But when it gets in your head, then that's when the temptation's there. Then we take it to God. We take it to the Word. Why? Because we want to maintain and don't get out of order. Or if I can put it in New Testament a little bit more, we want to stay in Christ.
Yes.
We want Jesus to show through us. So, transcendence, hierarchy, and ethics is what order, what the covenant is. Covenant in the Old Testament that God created with man, his relationship was definite of relationship. Come on, y'all make me feel bad. I'm supposed to be a good teacher. That's why I keep repeating it, because I want y'all to be in a position just to bark this stuff out. What's relationship?
A state of being connected.
Order. Change that word way into order. An order in which you stay, a state of being connected. An order. So covenant is that part of that order. Love is part of that order. And next week we're going to get into marriage, which is that order. And whoever can put this all together for me next week,
$10
car. $10 quick trip card. Everything I've just given you, and what does it mean? What is it substantiating, signifies? What is it all about? Why did God create all of it? I'm gonna tell you a little secret. Don't get too elaborate, because a lot of God has this thing put together. It's real simple. We have a tendency, because of our ego, want to complicate it. But it's all real simple. It was real simple in the beginning. Don't eat the tree. Don't eat the fruit of the tree. How much simpler can you get to that? Don't eat the fruit of the tree. Very simple. Obey God. Why? You want to seek understanding? They should have went to the Lord. They're right there. He was walking with them. Why you don't want to eat the tree, Lord? Then they would have got understanding. Mm. Instead of seeking understanding, ego took them off and they wanted to do something on their own. Yes, ma'am.
I have one little thing.
Yes.
That just occurred to me. Particularly when you were talking about, you know, seeking understanding. So I always want to take what I get from this class and apply it to what's happening in my own marriage. And what I came up with is a formula. Pastor Hill is always talking to us about being lukewarm. And I realized just a few minutes ago that I'm really lukewarm in my marriage. Hmm. I'm neither hot nor cold. Hmm. I'm just lukewarm. Hmm. And so the formula is, if you're lukewarm in my head, if you're lukewarm in your marriage, you are just out of order. Mm-hmm. Period. Hmm. And that's like, oh. It's like, I don't want to be out of order, because then, you know, I've broken all the covenants, and, you know, and now I'm just a mess.
We all are.
You know, best. Yeah. But again, it's, you know, my attempts at, you know, getting some sort of understanding, or how does it apply in my own marriage.
That will come as the Lord works with you. Mm-hmm. Do not, I've emphasized this at the beginning, do not take what you get in this class and try to apply it to your spouse. Internalize it for yourself, mm-hmm. that you become stronger in the relationship.
Oh, definitely.
And being you stronger in the relationship, then let it flow from you to your spouse.
Oh, definitely.
Denise, can I tell a quick story? I'm on this time. I think I've told y'all this story before about Smith Wigglesworth. Everybody know the story about Smith Wigglesworth? Mm-hmm. I'll tell it real quick for those who don't know. Quick, Smith Wigglesworth was a carpenter, a plumber. Mm-hmm. And wasn't saved at all, but his wife got saved, got to know the Lord, started going to church like a lot. Smith Wigglesworth, in a sense, got jealous of something, told his wife not to go to church. Mm-hmm. He said, but babe, I gotta go to church because that's what the Lord wants me to do. So she went to church anyway. She came back home, and Smith Wigglesworth, this mighty man of God, laid hands on people, brought them back to life and everything. She came back home, and he wouldn't let her in the door. Mm-hmm. So she just crawled up on the couch, on the porch, right in front of the door, mm-hmm. slept there all night. Smith Wigglesworth got up, go out to get the paper, and pushed the door open, and kind of hit her, woke her up. She got up, stayed in love. Good morning, Smith. Went on in the house, fixed his breakfast and everything. This blew Smith Wigglesworth's mind. And then they ended up in that. This led to Smith Wigglesworth getting married. Getting saved, mm-hmm. becoming what? One of the greatest evangelists in our time. Mm-hmm. So what did his wife do? His wife internalized mm-hmm. who she was in her position. Mm-hmm. Didn't take who she was, didn't take the word and beat him over the head. Mm-hmm. She just maintained who she was, love, mm-hmm. and acted in a way that the Holy Spirit was leading her to act. Mm-hmm. Yes, you can. You can't be that strong in yourself. Don't say that. No, you can. You can. You can't be that strong in yourself.
walking in the spirit type stuff. You can't, and don't. And we have to come to that. That's part of what I'm trying to get you to understand as married people. You have to get strong in the spirit. You have to get strong and understand who or what you are as an individual. You have to get strong with this. So if your spouse does stumble, you're not all messed up where you can't minister to them to bring them back. Like I tell you before, one of the things that I told my daughter, if you know if you really love somebody, if you know you really love them, at this time she was in the Lord, to know that you really love them, you were more concerned about their relationship with God than you are about your own. So the primary relationship is your spouse's relationship with God, because if they're strong and you're strong, then you're going to come to that spot where you're going to start speaking and things are going to start happening. You're going to come to that spot. You're going to come to that spot of intimacy. Because that's the key word that's happening with the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
There's an intimacy.
Is that another clue?
But I'll always no more time. So Denise can have a few minutes here for Denise. Come on, let's give her a hand. Denise, come on. Welcome back.
Everybody.
Good.
How's everybody?
Good.
Good. Well, we want to give a hand to Dee Dee and Jeremy tonight.
Yes.
So appreciative. It was very good. And I want to talk to you all today. Well, I want you all to kind of, let me give you a little homework. I want you to read Colossians 3. Verses 3 through 13.
You want us to do that now?
No, I want you all to read that, you know, the rest of the week. And
Colossians 3?
Mm-hmm. Verses 3 through 13.
Okay.
And in that you'll find a lot of the things that I used for parenting. And in parenting, first I had to get myself together. And that's what you'll find in reading Colossians 3. We don't have time. Michael's taking a little bit of my time, so I want to go on, and we'll talk about in detail next week. But I got a question to ask you. Do you feel right at this moment that you are the beloved of God? Just think about it for a minute. Do you feel you are the beloved of God? As Jesus, as John said, I am the beloved of God. Does anybody doubt that? Or don't feel it right now? Or do you feel it all the time? That you're the beloved of God. Well, I remember going to Rhema in my second year, and I was going through a whole lot of issues going on in my life. And my favorite instructor came out, and he says, I'm the beloved of God. You know, because God, I just feel that. I have taken that on. I am the beloved of God. And I'm sitting there thinking, I feel like a stepchild. I'm not feeling beloved at this moment. You know, I got so many things going on. I feel like a stepchild. God, where are you? You know, and so and he just kept ministering to that, you know. You have got to speak that out, that you are the beloved of God, no matter what circumstances are going on. You know, like Michael was talking about the chicken and the eagle. You've got to rise above that. You know, you are the beloved of God, and you wait for God to come in and rescue you and clear that situation out. But you've got to believe that you're the beloved. You know, because otherwise, if you don't, then the devil's coming in.
That's true.
You know, and he's going to put all kinds of things. So it's not going to just fly over your head. Mm-hmm. You know, it's going to get into your, you know, into your mind and your spirit. Mm-hmm. So one of my things with my kids And one of the reasons why I feel like I kind of attract other people around me is because, you know, I want to make them feel special in the natural first. You know, that, to me, that's very important. You know, as I was growing up, and even in my marriage relationship, I was always a favorite in my family. You know, yes. So I didn't have. So I never felt, you know, left out or, you know, I was always a favorite. You know, and so, but because of that feeling, you know, I notice how other people feel. Like, especially my children. So I always want my children to feel special. What's the reason for that, the purpose? The purpose is that they're my kids. God's given me these kids, and I'm supposed to raise them up, nurture them up, and then I'm supposed to give them back to God.
Yes. Uh-huh.
You know, so I've got to make that, I want to make that transition very smooth. Mm-hmm. You know, you've seen other people talking, oh, you know, I had a horrible dad, you know, and now you're talking about, you know, Father God, you know, it's like, you know, that relationship, I can't relate to a heavenly father that I can't see because my earthly father was so bad to me, you know. So my thing in nurturing was always to make them feel special, you know. So I go out of my way to spend special time, and I know I've talked about this before, but it's just very important that you make people special, you know, that are around you, you know. And what do you have to do to make them special? Not very much, you know. You give them a smile, you know. You talk about quality time, you know. Years ago, you know, spend quality time with your kids. I'm like, what? You know, give them 30 minutes and they should be good, you know. It's like, that don't make no sense, you know. Quality time is just, you know, to me it's mainly listening, you know, listening to kids, giving them a smile, recognizing them, you know, acknowledging that they are a person. So that's what I think that's really important for kids. They should know that they are loved. Because we have to send them off, and they've got to learn who Father God is, you know. So they have to know what love is, so to transition from the natural into the supernatural. That makes sense?
Yes.
Okay. So here's a little. I thought about this little example this afternoon. And it's something that we picked up years and years ago. And it's a story about, it's titled, Don't Get Mad, Get Glad. You remember that commercial? You know, when they would, you remember, you're looking at me, what are you talking about? Well, it was a commercial, in case you all don't remember. Yeah, it was about garbage. Yeah. It was about a garbage bag, right?
Yeah,
no, it was a garbage bag. And this lady, she would look at this garbage bag and it would bust.
That's right.
You know, and she'd be all mad, you know, and they said, don't get mad, get glad. Well, there was a story about this guy. He was talking about that, and he says, you know, they had cowboys and Indians, you know, and the cowboys were always raiding the Indians and, you know, trying to kill them and whatnot. And the Indians, you know, all they saw was the horses coming at them. And so they never noticed that the cowboys were on top of the horse, sitting on the horse, shooting them. The Indians, because, you know, horses are really big, you know. You know, I need like 5 steps to get up to the horse, you know, in order to get over, you know. Some people use 2, but anyway, a horse is really, it's almost eye level at you. And so the Indians, all they saw was a horse coming at them, and so they wanted to attack the horse. Because, you know, the Indians just had bow and arrows. But the cowboys had rifles, and they were shooting down at the Indians, okay? Well, the story is that we have got, in the spirit realm, we have got to look above Michael and I arguing, you know, because there's something on his head or on my head that is causing this friction and this argument. You know, so we have to learn to look above, which would be who? Satan and all of his demons are causing all of this havoc. You know, so as the Bible tells us in Ephesians, you know, that, you know, we don't wrestle against flesh and blood. We wrestle against powers and principalities and people in higher positions. So when we're in an argument with somebody, or someone's made you mad, you know, and you're arguing, and what does that do? That separates. Michael and I are like this. So when we get in an argument, he moves one way, I move, and we move apart from each other. So we have to remember that Satan wants to come in the middle and tear us apart. You see, or argue is, you know, starting, you know, and all this confusion. That's Satan over here, like the cowboy shooting down, you know, and all we see is the person in front of us. You know, so it's not all about who's in front of you, it's what's causing the issue in the beginning. You know, and that's where we get mad and go argue, you know, and take authority, you know, over that demon of, you know, it could be argument or confusion or lying, whatever the circumstance, you take authority over that. Somebody has got to say, wait a minute, what's going on here? You know, and now we need to, and sometimes you just have to walk away. Because with me, I have to walk away, you know, and get with God. Say, God, what's going on? You know, and then he'll say, okay, this is the issue. This is how you deal with it. Work through it. Mm-hmm. You see, so we don't get mad. We get glad.
That's right.
And so in that process of being glad, you've got to get with God and say, God, what's going on? You know, why am I feeling this way? Why am I upset? You know, it ain't about Michael that's causing me to be upset. Why am I feeling that? Then why am I reacting that way?
That's right.
You know, and so it could be something that he's done, that he said to spark that, but I need to bind that spirit, you know, and get a hold of the atmosphere and my emotions and my feelings again, you know. And that's what's important, because we're supposed to always have the spirit of love, you know. So we have to keep that environment in our household surrounded with love. So when Satan gets in there and causes that confusion, you know, and gets you, I mean, because he knows, unfortunately, Satan knows our tender spots,
right.
You know. And so we have to, you know, we have to be able to run to God and say, God, you know, help me through this, you know, take that arrow out my back, because, man, I'm so hurt, that hurts my feelings bad, you know. But we take that up in God's presence, and we fight and take that rifle, and we shoot Satan, not a husband, not a kid, you know. You know, we don't want to kill them. We're all about raising up and edifying each other, you know. And so, therefore, sometimes, as I told you before, that we have to keep our mouth shut. Sometimes God just tell you, shut up. Don't say nothing no more, you know, because you're about to tear him down with your mouth. You're about to cut him, you know, like Zorro with a sword, you know.
That's right.
You know, God said, no, you know, don't do that, you know, because you're causing me too much, have to mend him back up, you know. That's not necessary, you know. Deal with Satan himself and chop his head off. You know, so that we've given that spiritual authority. Let me see if I have one other point here. Well, the other thing is that in that same vein, the scripture is in Ephesians 4:6, be angry and sin not. You know, and then in Ephesians 4:29 and 32, you know, it says to watch your harsh words. You know, I used to have a nickname for Michael years ago that I'm not going to tell you, but it wasn't very nice, you know. And you know, we all have to grow. And I'm not saying that I'm, you know, look at me now. This is how I always was, you know. No, God has done a, you know, a miraculous work in me, you know. You know, I used to be on the phone with my girlfriends, and we were, get. He said, what's wrong? You mad with them? No, I ain't mad. We just having a conversation, you know? And so my mouth would just be running, you know? So as I was trying to learn to stop doing that, you know, I started writing this scripture down in Ephesians 4, 29 and 31. And I wrote it down and I read it every day. You know, and that's all I did was read it. You know, so I encourage you all to write down a scripture that touches your heart when you're reading. You know, put it on an index card, like the Ephesians, you know, telling you not to cuss your spouse out and not cuss your kids out, you know, and all those harsh words that you use, you know. And just reading God's word and not doing anything. You don't have to try to memorize it, you know, you don't have to try to put it in practice. Just read it. Because God's word is alive and sharper than any two-edged sword. You know? And it will just get into your spirit and just change you. You know, just by reading it. You know, so that's one thing that I did, and it really worked, and you know, wasn't much effort at all to do except for reading it, you know. You know, like the doctor says, you know, take this pill twice a day, you know. It's like you take God's word twice a day. You know, if there's any particular area that you're trying to, you know, deal with and get rid of, just find the scripture and read the word. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen. I got an awesome
wife,
though.
Yes. Amen. Amen.
Awesome. Well, she brought up one thing I just have to mention about, because I don't understand about pushing buttons. Satan will push your buttons. Anytime you hear a doorbell, you hear something ding dong. Doorbell, that's Satan. Well, if you hear a that's Jesus.
All right.
Jesus. All right. Jesus will push your button. Jesus will knock on your door. He won't push your button.
Yeah.
Well, God, I just wanted to bring it out real quick.
Brother Michael,
yes.
Along with what Sister Denise was saying, I have a good scripture.
Go ahead.
Proverbs 15:1. A soft answer turneth away wrath, a grievous word stirreth up anger. That's a good one.
Soft answer.
Everybody, get somebody that has any questions? I got one statement to make, though. Don't ask me what that nickname was. I won't tell you.
I was going to ask you.
And when she used to say it, I used to go, okay. Okay.
Can we Google it?
Google it? No, you can't Google it. Me being a man of water, like I always keep saying, I've got to feel a little covered in this. I can have my pastor prayers out of here. On this evening. Why? At least get it.
Okay.
Pastor Hill, anytime you get ready, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Lord. Father, we thank you for your word, and we thank you, Father, for the dominion that you have given us and as sons of God. We thank
yes.
you, Father, that we look at the dominion of Jesus and we can see the dominion that you gave us through Adam by looking at how Jesus walked and how he lived and how he conducted his life. And Lord, our desire is to emulate that life.
Yes.
And we are to love even as he loved us.
Yes.
And Father, we know that greater love hath no man than the love that he had for us. He laid down his life.
Yes.
And we ought to lay down ours for one another. Father, we thank you because we receive the love of God just by what Christ laid down and what he did, the sacrifice he made, the thing that he relinquished and gave up just to bring us to the place where we can experience the life that we have.
Yes.
Father, we thank you that he commended his love toward us. He loved us with an everlasting love. And Father, help us to be shed abroad in our hearts day by day by the Holy Ghost. And Father, we thank you for the Holy Ghost that you have sent to indwell us. And we know that the Holy Ghost that dwells in us is that very life that Christ came to impart to us.
Yes,
Lord. And we thank you, God, for that life.
Yes, God.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
The Spirit of the law of life,
thank you,
Christ,
yes,
Jesus,
thank you, God,
makes us free from the law of sin and death.
Yes, God.
That same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead,
yes,
dwells in us and will also quicken our mortal bodies. We thank you, God, for that light being manifested through us. And we thank you, God, that love, hallelujah, is not in words, but in deed and in truth.
Yes.
Hallelujah. And we thank you, God, because that love is the thing that motivates us, the thing that constrains us. It's the thing that gives us the ability, Father, to live and to walk even as you walk. Father, we commit our lives to you anew, afresh. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
We want to be
like you.
And we count all but loss for that knowledge of you. God, give us a revelation of what it means to love one another and to walk as you walk. Give us that revelation and praise. We pray that the eyes of our understanding will be enlightened so we might know the hope of his calling, the riches of the glory of the inheritance that we can find in Christ and that exceeding power. Hallelujah. That power that was present when Christ was raised again from the dead. Lord, we want to know you in your fullness. Because in your fullness, in your presence, Father, there is fullness of joy. And at your right hand, there are pledges evermore. Father, we give you praise and glory in Jesus' name.
Jesus.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen.